This week in the markets, the gold shares blasted into orbit, the highest close in at least 6 months, while U.S. equities posted a record-smashing six-week winning streak. Well, welcome back to Gold Seek Radio, everyone. Your host, Chris Waltzek, back with you on this Season 14, Episode 681 show. This Super Bowl Sunday weekend, millions of viewers will be watching the New England Patriots, Super Bowl 53, as the five-time Super Bowl champ Bill Belichick and Tom Brady try to win their third championship in 5 years against the Washington Redskins. And speaking of Super Bowls, we have our own former player back on the show this weekend. Bill Murphy from Gotta returns with play-by-play action from the 50-yard line on the gold market. He has good news for already ebullient gold stock aficionados. The current theme of mergers in the gold mining industry suggests better things to come for the gold shares. Arch Crawford, head of Crawford Perspectives, returns with more good news on the technical side of the precious metals market. He suggests we might be gearing up for a multi-year advance, just what people want to hear as we try to ascend above 1,400. Mad Money's Jim Cramer agrees with him. He says we're headed to $1,500 a share. And Robert Ann returns with his latest must-hear report. We'd like for you to call into the Q&A hotline, 641-715-3900. You'll need our extension number, 514049. 641-715-3900, extension number 514049. You can call in 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Plus, we continue to make progress on the search for signals outside of the Earth. We're looking at several different news sources. If you'd like to contribute or you'd just like to get involved, just send me a message at aliensignalhunters@gmail.com. That's aliensignalhunters, all one word, @gmail.com. We'd like to have you on board. Goldseek.com radio begins now with a market weather recap. Visibility virtually unlimited over the precious metals market this week, as signs of an extremely robust U.S. economy hinted at potential inflation, encouraging precious metals investors. At Friday's closing bell, gold was up $16, finishing at $13.22. Silver was up about 2%. Around 30 cents, just shy of $16. But it was the XAU precious metal shares that finished at around 76, adding 3 for the week. Black gold picked up 3% at 55 and a quarter, well off the $42 per barrel lows just a few weeks earlier. And palladium, virtually a tie with the yellow metal at 13.13, while its sister metal, platinum, was up about $8 at $8.27, a big relative bargain. The top story driving the metals higher this week, gold gained about 3% last month, tallying its fourth straight monthly advance as the Fed left interest rates unchanged, adding dovish guidance comments from economic policymakers that they said they'll be patient, suggesting rates would stay put for the time being. News that the Fed held rates steady at 2.25 to 2.5 was good news for the markets. The Fed Chairman Jerome Powell noted on Wednesday the case for rate increases had weakened. He saw little risk of inflation or recession, but noted slowing growth overseas and possible reverberations on the heels of the government shutdown, clouding his economic crystal ball a bit. Powell surprised investors, essentially calling for renewed QE operations, noting that the Fed could end up with a larger balance sheet. This just after having limited their purchases and having sold nearly $1 trillion off the balance sheet. CNBC's Jim Cramer commented, noting that Powell did the right thing. He said patience is right when it comes to future hikes, and he stuck with his plan, noting that it would have been devastating if he had veered from that playbook. Elsewhere, the Spiders gold shares, ticker GLD, the largest gold-backed ETF, was up nearly 3% for the year so far. Holdings, the highest level in nearly 7 months. According to the World Gold Council, GLD holds, wait for it, $100 billion worth of gold. I'll settle for just 1% of that. Bottom line on the precious metals. Well, as I mentioned, Mad Money's Jim Cramer says he's a believer. We're big gold believers here now that it's at 1,300 and we're well above that. We think we're headed to 1,400, even 1,500. He suggests everybody needs to have a little bit of gold in their portfolios. Is Jim watching and listening to Goldseek? He also reiterated my alpha stock candidate's favorite gold stock, Barrick. We're both on board here, ticker G-O-L-D, one of my best gold picks now for months. Moving on to the Wall Street Report, sunny skies persisted over Wall Street, with the major indexes posting the sixth consecutive winning week on much better than expected jobs numbers from the U.S. Labor Department. The New York Stock Exchange revealed the Dow up 327 points at 25,063, regaining that critical point. Meanwhile, the S&P 500 added 42 on the sixth winning week in a row, 2706, while the Nasdaq picked up 100 points, ending at 7263, while the Bitcoin ETF GBTC gave back just 4%, holding above $4 in still a bit of a precarious position. In related news, the risk-on mantra echoed on the New York Stock Exchange on the news that Facebook, General Electric, and Apple had surprised Wall Street analysts with their quarterly earnings reports. The Facebook social media behemoth posted fourth quarter results, besting analyst estimates, sending the stock higher on Thursday. GE saw similar outcomes. The shares of the industrial giant gained the most in about 9 years, blasting higher this week by 11%. Of course, it was recently off 80 to 85%, so this is a rebound performance. Meanwhile, the U.S. President Donald Trump noted Thursday another high-level meeting would take place with Chinese President Xi Jinping to smooth out trade negotiations between Washington and Beijing. Reports suggested that Washington is expecting the March 1st hard deadline for negotiators to be met to avoid stricter trade tariffs on our largest trading partner. In related news, the U.S. Labor Department noted 304,000 new jobs created last month, blasting through estimates of about half that number, according to economists polled by MarketWatch. The robust numbers followed the longest partial government shutdown in history, 35 days, and it was essentially a non-event. In other words, the economy is so strong, it simply did nothing negative, you might say, to the economic output numbers. However, the unemployment rate did edge up just a bit to 4% from 3.9%, but the average wage paid inched up higher as well. U.S. shares, bottom line. Well, the greed to fear index suggests the herd is starting to get just a touch greedy here. However, the rebound is so impressive and the economic activity is as well. For the time being, I'm going to remain in the neutral to positive camp, cautiously optimistic and very excited for the U.S. shares bulls. Coming up after the break, more Goldseek Radio and Alien Signal Hunters audio. So stay tuned.
The blockchain revolution is transforming the global arena, disrupting every industry in its path. Goldseek.com is excited to introduce an off-the-chain opportunity in digital gold and silver from our friends at Atmex and Sprott.com. One Gold holds physical gold and silver metals at the Royal Canadian Mint, the first online marketplace to offer secure and convenient buying, selling, and redemption of digital precious metals. One Gold uses Vault Chain, a secure, immutable blockchain ledger developed by TradeWind Markets, the leading innovator in digital precious metals distributed ledger and blockchain technology. Vault Chain. Gold and silver are 100% redeemable through One Gold for physical precious metals delivered to customers' doors in any size at competitive prices and low transaction storage costs. As a special offer and for a limited time only, One Gold is offering gold and silver at spot price with no additional premiums. OneGold.com is secure and accessible 24/7 on any device, offering convenient purchases and sales of precious metals. Easy recurring transactions make passive saving and gold dollar cost averaging as easy as a single mouse click.
Vault Chain
offers the best tier pricing on AppMex products, setting the industry standard as a fully backed physical asset with easy redemption in coins, rounds, or bars, offering clients peace of mind and full transparency. Don't get left behind. Remember to bookmark OneGold.com for the safest and most convenient digital precious metals today. Remember, OneGold.
GoldSeek employees may or may not own shares. Nothing contained herein should be construed as investment advice.
It's just a pleasure to welcome back Arch Crawford from Crawford Perspectives. Over four decades of experience divining patterns within the astronomical anomalies using technical analysis as well. Welcome back, Arch Crawford.
Thank you very much.
It's great to have you. And before the show, we were discussing this very unique, fast radio burst from deep space found, believe it or not, by Harvard and confirmed all around the world. And there are beacons, music, and things that sound very otherworldly, Arch. I don't know. Do you think this is just a Department of Defense new communication?
I know that there have been aliens working in our high level in our government in math and physics that aren't even known by most of the other people in the government. It's a most secret thing that there is. And now the Chinese have landed stuff on the far side of the moon where they're supposed to be hanging out over there.
Don't forget Ramanujan. If you look in his equations, it's very difficult to even begin to decipher. And he had just booklets and booklets filled with things that are still 50 years later, they're trying to begin to grasp. And it all just came to him. I mean, I haven't seen it. I think that's called The Man Who Loved Only Numbers. That movie was on the life of Paul Erdős, the mathematician who was also autistic. Fascinating. So you can see that free, by the way, on YouTube. Yeah, it was close. It had Jeremy Irons in it and an Indian fellow. Right. Srinivasa Ramanujan is the subject. And of course, he was a astounding mathematician who at a very early age just became enraptured by mathematics. Then he became deathly ill. And so he was unable to do much of anything other than math. It's a fascinating story. I've read his biography at least four times. And frankly, my favorite is one you and I have discussed, which of course is an imaginary tale of the square root of negative one. You start to unlock the world of complex numbers. And so, you know, I spent a whole Saturday afternoon, boring day, just tinkering around with, you know, the square root of minus one. Well, that equals I. So all you have to do is just transfer the square root via a square, and you find out that I squared equals minus one. And if you start to use the little graph, you know, with instead of just a number line, but you have a vertical and where they intersect, you can see that it's a giant spiral. It's a giant circle there. This all kind of ties back in with the fact to divine patterns in the heavens, and that's harmonics.
Recitations in the Hebrew language is desire of desires, that which hangeth in that region which is negatively existent in the ancient one.
And one of the more interesting stories you talked about before the show, about Al Bielek and how he claimed to transport to a different galaxy, the Andromeda Galaxy, I think you said, and Alpha Centauri.
Yeah, Alpha Centauri. He said he was on a planet of Alpha Centauri, and that he went through a wormhole to get there, worked all day, came back home in time for dinner.
Occam's Razor says, let's be objective first and then subjective. So the first thing that came to my mind was, well, DOD's top secret project, they need to have fast burst communications from a satellite, and that each 2 seconds of this fast radio burst arch contains 23 minutes times 40 of compressed information. This one little 10-second radio burst, 10 or 15-second radio burst, required more energy than our entire sun to send, because they claim it came just from a neutron star. What I believe, if this is found to be authentic, Arch, they piggybacked it. Some race somewhere, or it interfered with the signal from the neutron star. Let's send them a little galactic Rosetta Stone, or NASA Golden Record, because there's beacons, and then after the beacons comes amphibian-like gibberish.
If I were, let's say, a science fiction writer, we don't know what level we're sending to, and we don't know what type of creature we're sending to. It might be an insectoid. It might be fish planet. It might be a cuttlefish or an octopus or a squid, a humanoid, a mammal, a bird. You don't know. Are you on a large planet where the gravity's strong? Are you on a planet with, like us, weaker gravity, a computer or a digital, a silicon race or a carbon-based race? Onto the markets today. Let's just jump right in. Did you continue your monthly strategy of buying puts into the stock market sell-off? And what do you see?
NASDAQ 100s had rallied back up to a down-sloping neckline of an important pattern, and it had been a breakaway gap at the bottom of it. And I said there's this exhaustion gap up near the top of that downtrending neckline. And I just sent that out to just everybody and posted it on LinkedIn and Facebook and Google Plus. That was the top rally of the rally in the NASDAQ 100, and it collapsed from there. And I posted on Facebook that I would short the market before the 2 o'clock FOMC announcement, which was the exact top.
Well, maybe we should ask you to fund some of our research here with some of these new earned profits into looking for an alien code. If this is legit, again, very low probability, but if it is, this happens to be a repeating fast radio burst. There will be more. Think it wouldn't be hard to see there might be an intriguing business model. People would start to speculate there's another fast radio burst coming. But again, you know, the file is available for everyone at Harvard. You know, you can download it, anyone who's interested. This stock market sell-off, have we seen the bottom? A lot of folks seem to think we've seen the bottom.
Happened many times in the past where it has a top and it drops off the first leg and then it rallies back up to the 50-day moving averages, which is still in a steep decline. And then the 50-day moving averages, they turn back down and then crash. And we're just back up to the 50-day moving averages now, so we haven't really had the crash. And then we're coming into a three-day holiday with Martin Luther King closed up on Monday. And in the meantime, in the middle of the weekend, is the most powerful supermoon lunar eclipse in a long, long time. At 1 degree, at 0 degrees of Leo. So I'm...
Okay, let's bump on over to the gold market. A lot of interest waking up there. We find out that China just increased their gold stockpile, their reserves. We've also heard that in 27 currencies, gold is reaching all-time highs. That's not quite the U.S. dollar, but in these alternative currencies.
Potential bottoming pattern, and then the neckline is at about 1365 to 1380, closer to the 1365 on this end of it. In the meantime, there was a rising trend channel line from middle of 2016, which broke down in June, and we've come back up to that, which is now resistance, which it was supposed to support it. And it's now resistance, and it's back up to that trend line. Trend channel line, the bottom of a trend channel that had been going up. So I'm saying that I think the greater likelihood is we'll get some pullback from that, but a break above 1300 on volume and momentum could turn the tables and have to say, well, maybe this is more serious uptrend. But I'm not going to be long-term super bullish on it until it breaks up through the five-year neckline at 1365 to 1380.
Interesting. So we're still not quite at a technical point, an inflection point where we can definitively say the bear market is over, or at least the bear phase.
Well, the most positive thing it's done in quite a while is consolidating underneath the 200-week moving average. And it finally broke up out of it at about 1230, 35. Then we've had this very, very strong short-term move up to the heavier resistance level now. We'll see how much it pulls back, if it stays above the 200-week moving average, things like that. But it's going to need some more work, whether it's a straight line breakout straight up. It's still going to have to complete technical patterns before I'm super bullish on it. But I said in the last two or three letters that it's okay for traders who can quick in and get out quickly if things go wrong to put a toe back in the water, but I wouldn't recommend it for normal investor. But, you know, again, you have to be sophisticated somewhat as a trader to with the risk.
Yeah, it's very tricky, even with play money. But I do recommend Thinkorswim at TD Ameritrade for folks. They give you 100,000 play money, and it's a fantastic platform. Tinker with that for a few years before you put a single dollar into trading. Because, as you know, the fastest way to make $1 million, you know, to end up with $1 million account as a trader, Arch, is to start trading with $1 billion account. Over the past few years, you've had an uncanny ability to pinpoint difficult times in the markets. Oftentimes, you seem to have a grasp on volatility within political world. This is not a political show. I'm a political atheist. I can never remember any period as politically unstable as Washington seems to be today. Half of Europe, the city streets are on fire right now. I'm not convinced we couldn't see something similar here. I don't want to upset people. I don't want no fear porn, as they call it today. However, I would point out the EBT cards. Approximately 50 million households rely on EBT cards, food stamp debit cards. What I'm hearing is in many places they can't accept the food stamp debit cards anymore because of the government shutdown. Does the French Revolution and the Widowmaker and La Guillotine start to sound familiar? I'm just a little concerned about serious yellow vest style or worse unrest.
Well, we're getting extreme. This weekend, about as extreme as it gets. So I'm looking for... It would not be surprising to see terrorist activity or people uprising within the country. I'm not going to say any more. The most destructive things will come in with the Saturn-Pluto in 2020, much worse than whatever we get now.
If you were to speculate, you're seeing some signs that maybe parallel the disturbing type of social unrest that seems to be brewing just below the surface in North America and Europe. It just seems like things like extreme polarity between both sides politically here just don't seem to bode well. Add in the government shutdown. I guess that maybe the key takeaway is maybe start thinking defensively with your portfolio.
Well, yes, but I'd say this is a long, long-term situation that's been building for decades. Both the Republicans have been going along with the movement towards socialism and communism, which has totally taken over the Democratic Party, has largely taken over the Republican Party too, and that's why so many of the Republicans hate Trump, because he's actually trying to take us back to a constitutional republic. The grassroots people said enough of this, of all these promises to us, and then never following through to protect our way of life. We're going to do something different that you don't like, and hopefully it'll drain the swamp. So all of the swamp people, including the rhinos and the dream radicals, it's been building a long time, and this is the first time someone has risen up and said enough is enough in decades. But we're coming also up to the period where, what's his name that wrote after the Revolutionary War came and looked over everything from France and wrote that the problem with a democracy is it always goes to a strong man, because once the people discover that they can vote themselves largesse, you have to have someone come in and strong enough and say, you can't have any more candy.
I know who you're referring to. He did make a very interesting point. He said, America is great because she is good. The people ever cease being decent, good folks, America will cease to be great. And the question I pose to you and the listeners is, are we good? And if not, then are we losing our greatness? What good is salt if it loses its saltiness? It's nothing more than sand.
The salt have lost his savor. What good is it but to be thrown out and trampled under the foot?
And, of course, I am certainly no saint. Really quickly turning into a complaint-a-thon. Arch Garvard, thanks so much. And if you could tell folks maybe a little bit more about the must-have material that they can find through your hotlines as well as your webpage.
Well, the CrawfordPerspectives.com is the location, but you can always just Google Arch Crawford, and it'll take you there, and it'll have our phone numbers and our emails, and we are definitely like you. We like to talk to people, and if we convince them to send money, that'll be fine too.
Fantastic. Well, Arch, I'm going to send over, as promised, the 6-series Frank Herbert's Dune must read in just a neat little text format over to your email in just a few minutes. And we also have another book we've been trying to send to you for a decade. And we will keep you apprised of this intriguing, although uncertain, story about communications through the fast radio burst.
Very good, sir. Thank you.
The blockchain revolution is transforming the global arena, disrupting every industry in its path. GoldSeek.com is excited to introduce an off-the-chain opportunity in digital gold and silver from our friends at Atmex and Sprott.com. One Gold holds physical gold and silver metals at the Royal Canadian Mint, the first online marketplace to offer secure and convenient buying, selling, and redemption of digital precious metals. One Gold uses Vault Chain, a secure, immutable blockchain ledger developed by Tradewind Markets, the leading innovator in digital precious metals distributed ledger and blockchain technology. Vault Chain. Gold and silver are 100% redeemable through One Gold for physical precious metals delivered to customers' doors in any size at competitive prices and low transaction storage costs. As a special offer and for a limited time only, One Gold is offering gold and silver at spot price with no additional premiums. OneGold.com is secure and accessible 24/7 on any device, offering convenient purchases and sales of precious metals. Easy recurring transactions make passive saving and gold dollar cost averaging as easy as a single mouse click. Vault Chain offers the best tier pricing on AppMex products, setting the industry standard as a fully backed physical asset with easy redemption in coins, rounds, or bars, offering clients peace of mind and full transparency. Don't get left behind. Remember to bookmark OneGold.com for the safest and most convenient digital precious metals today. Remember, OneGold.
GoldSeek employees may or may not own shares. Nothing contained herein should be construed as investment advice.
It's a pleasure. Welcome back, Bill Murphy. Wanted to talk to you a little bit about the gold market. We're hearing that gold mergers are picking up, and some folks are saying that they think that's because there's just not enough finds. There's no major Eldorados out there. Is this indicative of, you know, opportunity in the metals market?
Well, sure it is. I mean, it's also indicative of many, many bottoms and then other markets and so on and mergers. And, you know, things have been very tough outside of very few exceptions in the gold silver sector now for so long that things are just drying up. I mean, think about when the last major discovery was. They've been few and far between actually for 10 or 15 years now. And so it's only natural that there would be mergers and acquisitions and so on.
That's exactly right. I mean, we're reading gold is moving higher in something like 25 currencies near all-time highs. So although we're not seeing it in U.S. dollars and maybe euros, it's starting to get the attention of these inflated currency nations.
Well, all I know is, because I'm, you know, a U.S. guy, is that it's really been in the doldrums forever. I mean, think about back to 2011, what has happened, what other assets have done. The gold shares right now are comatose. And quite frankly, there's not much interest. I mean, there's going to be, and it's, you know, being a Super Bowl, it's going to be spectacular. But you look the way the HUI trades and interest in some of the smaller companies, regardless of these higher prices in other countries, it really hasn't done that much for the share sector.
And we haven't seen any of the interest from the big nations, but we are seeing it from Russia and China still. I mean, we've just heard that China's increased its reserves by as much as 2,000 tons. There are official numbers. Who knows what's going on behind the scenes? Russia also increasing silver and gold stockpiles. Any thoughts?
You know, that's a good point. We don't know really how much they have. We know what they say. We don't know if they're real. We don't even know what the United States has, since there hasn't been an audit in 60, 70 years. And so we're not putting our true numbers out there for people to really understand. Certainly the Russians and Chinese are probably not doing so either.
You mentioned there hasn't been any accountability. We just heard from former presidential candidate Congressman Ron Paul that he's thinking there's no sense in trying to abolish the Fed when they can't even have any accountability at all. Do you see some continued drama between Washington and the Federal Reserve, and what does that mean for the markets?
Same old verbal back and forth that goes on forever. This way, it's that way, we're going to do this, not do this. The Fed seems to have kowtowed a little bit to what President Trump wants and the establishment in terms of interest rates, but that can change pretty quickly. And you know, as I said, you know, the Fed and gold is a whole different subject, and we talked to Congressman Paul Chris Powell and I over the years, and went down to Washington and tried to get him to really get into the issue. And even he, who's a great guy, he really doesn't want to touch it with a 10-foot pole, quite frankly. I mean, we've been to his office and spoke to him and had him questions asked the monetary committees, and he backed away.
Do you see that we'll eventually have increased interest in the XAU, the gold and silver shares? We saw them perk up for a few weeks.
Well, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, I mean, it's been so dead in terms of the prices in the U.S. market for so long, and other assets have done so well, people have lost interest. I mean, stock market corrections, they never last. Whether it's the plunge protection team, which Mnuchin called into action around Christmas time and take it back up, and you've got the gold cartel has gone berserk again just lately, stopping the gold price above pitiful 1290, 13, 15 times in a row, and then have taken it straight down, and the open interest has gone crazy to the upside, and they're just there, and people are beginning to understand it. Until they're beaten or overrun by the physical market, which I think is coming, we go through the same drills, and people are sick and tired of it.
We're clearly permabulls on the precious metals because we recognize the fact that this game could change in a heartbeat. But so many of our guests here, they're not gold bugs. They have no iron in the fire as far as the long-term perspective, you know, the bullish stance on the sector, almost unanimously turning bullish here. Don't you, from a contrarian perspective, at least see that as a positive sign?
The contrarian sign for me is when nobody wants anything to do with it, creates a bottom. But, you know, the fundamental reasons for gold and silver to soar, and they will, and that's why you and I are the perma gold silver bulls, at least I speak for myself, because, as you say, all of a sudden these factors that we're all aware of, whatever it is, you know, the debt and, you know, money printing and all kinds of things and commotion and unsettling nature and, you know, all over the world, all of a sudden they won't matter, and then all of a sudden they will matter, and they'll matter at the same time. And I don't believe we're going to have gradual markets this time. I think we're going to see explosions when gold and silver finally turn, and this gold cartel, as I call it, is overrun, and they will be. But right now, again, we're going through the same drill where they're trying to flush out the specs in gold and silver, and we've seen it ever since 2011, and they're at it again. Whether it'll last this time or work, I don't know. The odds are for them, but one day it's all going to change, like you said.
Let's talk about the fundamentals for a moment. Clearly, we've seen the Fed reduce its balance sheet by, I want to say, close to $1 trillion, pulled back to the $3 trillion level, you know, reverse QE. It's QT, if you will. They're tightening up a bit, but we haven't returned to the post-2008 levels. We're nowhere near there, you know, and interest rates are still a bit sticky. They don't seem to have the wiggle room to address the financial market volatility that they had just a decade earlier. That would seem to be a good recipe for holding on and procuring more precious metals. Your thoughts?
Well, I think that's true, and that's what's going to lead to something spectacular. What, you know, that always bugs me, and you talk about quantitative easing, well, that should have been extremely bullish for gold and silver. And, of course, it was till 2011, and then the bad guys, as I call them, got their plans together and decided to go into attack, taking silver first down in April and stopping gold in September. And it's been, quite frankly, for many of us, a horror show ever since. It's all about the gold cartel, in my opinion. These other factors, it don't matter. I mean, they should matter, and they will. But as long as the bad guys have enough physical silver and gold to help their paper selling, they control things. And it's yes, it is going to blow up, and probably when I least expect it, but it is coming. So that's the reason for me, anyway, to be permanently bullish, because the returns will be spectacular and probably, again, as I mentioned, come out of nowhere.
Shift over to AG silver. You know, we've witnessed something intriguing occur, you know, in the palladium markets, haven't we? Palladium just seemed like over a decade ago was trading around $200-$300. And we've recently eclipsed gold in the palladium market. What's to stop silver from also having this type of unexpected advance that just stuns the financial community?
Well, that's a good point. And, of course, palladium, as soon as they got all the attention, above 1400, and it's suddenly tanked over $100. But that's the way markets go. But, yes, I look for silver to do that. But I've been bullish on silver for a while now. And quite frankly, it's one of the worst acting markets I've ever seen in 45 years. Because that way, at 1470, we had a pop below 1470, popped to 1570. Now it's going right back in the dumpster again. And I think, but you're correct that it will, when it goes, and J.P. Morgan runs out of enough physical silver to control this thing, it will trade like platinum has. And if we get above 21, and I've said this a number of times on your show, I think it's going to go to $100 an ounce faster than anybody can imagine, in similar fashion to what palladium has just done.
That's interesting you'd mention that, because Bob at Trade Genius mirrors your sentiments on silver. He sees $50 in short order once things get moving and beyond. Wanted to talk, though, about platinum, palladium's cousin there, down around $700-$800 value relative to palladium. And it's also, as I understand the catalytic conversion process, it's exchangeable for palladium in that process by automakers, you know, for gas-powered engine production. Why haven't traders picked up on the relative value between palladium and platinum? Is there just not the maybe shortage in stockpiles?
You know, I've talked to John Embry about this all the time, and we can't figure it out. At least I'll speak for myself, but I don't think John can either, what they've done to platinum and how it's just been destroyed, even relative to the other metals. I mean, it's really been a horror show. I just don't understand that market at all, and it wouldn't surprise me, though, if it's not part of the gold cartel's drill to do it. But they've done the silver, do the same thing, the platinum, same thing, except much worse.
So you feel that eventually we might see platinum catch up with palladium, or too early to call?
I try to stick with what I think I know, and so far I'm way too early, and that's that silver is going to go like platinum when it all turns, and we don't see any sign of it yet, but it's coming.
I mean, you might agree that we've seen some signs of it. We're so used to being disappointed by these metals of the past few years.
From 1470 to 1570, it can't get above that. 7 years after it went to near 50, and what, 39 years or whatever since it was at 50 in 1980. And I'm the biggest bull going, and it's been very tough to deal with because I think I know what's coming, but it gets delayed and delayed. And just recently again, you said it, you're right, we'd get disappointed. Look at the price action. It can't get out of its own way again.
I'd point to 2019 as the year where the Fed starts considering quantitative easing again. And if we start to see that Titanic move around and then their colleagues get on board, that would seem to be a big fundamental shift in favor.
It all comes down to me is the amount of supply this gold cartel has in gold and silver. If they don't have enough to aid their selling in the paper market, they're finished. And it's coming. We just don't know when. It's taking longer than many of us thought, but it's coming. And when that happens, you can throw everything else out and gold and silver will just explode.
The last word with that right there, Bill Murphy from Gata.org. Why don't you tell people a bit more about La Metropole Cafe, what they'll find there, and of course, Gata.org?
Well, I've been doing it for 20 years, call it the cafe, and people can sign up for a 2-week free trial. It's www.lametropolecafe.com. And then Chris Powell does a great job at www.gata.org and sends out stuff all the time. And he's on the case with the media and everybody trying to get the word out there about what's going. Because it's not what we want to do is have this manipulation scene exposed, which you've been trying forever. People won't talk about to end this nightmare. And we're going to keep at it. Thank you, Chris.